Blog Talk Radio.
Chatting with Nat is a podcast for independent women seeking to speak their truth and to break down barriers. We host honest conversations that help to guide and empower women. Speak your truth and set yourself free. Let your voice be heard.
Hi everyone, it's Natalie Jean. Yes, it's Chatting with Nat, and today I have the honor of having Billboard artist and songwriter Gina Cutillo. Billboard artist and acclaimed songwriter Gina Cutillo continues to release fresh music ranging from pop to rock and dance. Her single Keep On debuted at number 34 on the Billboard Top 40 mainstream chart. Gina also toured with Katy Perry and others on Warped Tour. She also has song placements on Oprah, Nickelodeon, Mean Girls 2, Barbara Walters, MLB, Food Network, Degrassi, E! Network, VH1, and more. Gina Cutillo's music is placed and heard all over the world. Her recent singles Kiss Kiss and Runaway can be heard on every major digital platform. Let's give a round of applause for Gina.
Hello.
Hi, Gina. How are you?
Good. How are you, Nat?
I'm all right. You know, I like to make people feel welcome because me clapping by myself just doesn't do it. Loved.
I do. I feel the love. I was going to say, wow, that's quite an audience there. I mean, it's been a minute since I've been around an audience, but that was great. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. So how have you been during this pandemic?
Well, probably as everyone else has been. It's, you know, in the beginning, hard, you know, to be locked down. I live in New York, so we were really locked down for quite some time, and we're just opening up like next week, like fully. Mm-hmm. So it was tough, you know. I had to do some homeschooling. I have a 9-year-old son, and that was challenging. It was fun, but it was a little challenging. So I was happy to have him back in school this September. Yeah, I mean, I don't know if you're a mom, but yes, it's like pencils flying, me running to the driveway, just like breathing, because, you know, it's hard. These kids are so used to being with, you know, teachers. Like, you're not supposed to be mom, teacher, and friend, and, you know, disciplinary. It was a challenge. But I did get to write a lot of music. I did that. So
awesome. That's awesome. And kudos to you for having to homeschool and learn and go back to school at the same time. Because I think a lot of parents are like, oh, my God, I haven't done this in years. Now I'm having to go over the homework with my child and relearn some of the stuff. Cause I don't have children, but, my God, if I had to go through a lot of the same things you did in elementary school, even high school, my head would probably spin off.
Yeah, I mean, I was teaching second grade math, and they do it very differently now. And I was like, what is this? I'm like, why are you taking all those steps? You don't need to do that. It's just very simple. It's like, subtract this from this. You don't need to add extra decimal. She's like, well, Mommy, that's the way we do it. I'm like, well, not anymore. We're homeschooling.
That's right. You're doing it my way. No, I like that. Take an action there. Did you do any live streaming?
Did I do any what?
Live streaming.
Yes, I actually did, and it's still all up there. Like, I did, you know, from home, I did a lot. I went through different phases. In the beginning, it was like kind of, you know, it was really hard not to be rehearsing with my band and booking shows and traveling and dealing with licensing companies because kind of everyone shut down.
Right.
So at first, I wanted nothing to do with music. I was like, forget it, it's over. That's it, you know. You go through those stages, and then all of a sudden I started feeling like, oh, I gotta do something. So I started writing, and then I'm like, you know what? Why don't I start live streaming? So then I started doing TikToks, and I went on my face. And so I did. Yeah, I did some acoustic stuff. It's out there. So, yeah, it was fun, though.
Yeah, I found that, you know, as artists, you know, we have to keep the fans engaged. I had never done any live streaming before and was working with B Square Management. They're like, well, you should do this. So sometimes I had people there. Sometimes I had a lot of people there. Sometimes I was just singing to myself. But that's okay because I had the, you know, it gave me some practice, like to remember my lyrics. Because half the time I can't remember, I'll make up something. Because, you know, because when I perform, sometimes it's a 3-hour performance. And so that's about 30 songs. And
wow.
Whoever thinks that Natalie can remember all that stuff by heart, you can forget it.
When in doubt, just sing the note. Sometimes they don't even know what you're saying.
Exactly, and I do that sometimes just to see if anybody's paying attention. And I'll just throw in a word, and they're just, oh my God, that sounds so great. It's crazy. How would you describe your music?
It's funny because I'm listening to you talk my bio and talk about my music. I'm like, oh yeah, pop, rock, dance. Ultimately, I would say I'm like the birth child of Madonna and Kurt Cobain. Like someone said that to me one day, and I was like, that is me. That is like, I love, you know, I came from a lot of Motown. My mother was a singer, and she sang a lot of doo-wop in the house and Motown and love Etta James. So that was like my initial, you know, bringing up of music. And then, of course, when you're a young kid, you're like, all right, now I want to listen to this stuff. And I was like, oh, Madonna. That was Madonna, Michael Jackson. Those were my still are my loves. And then as I became older and, you know, grunge came out in Nirvana, I was like, ooh, right. Hole. I'm like, this is my jam. And PJ Harvey, I was like, now I want to know how to play guitar. Like, I can sing, but now I want to learn to play guitar. And that's what I did. I taught myself. And so when people say, like, what is your sound? I was, you know, it's got that pop rock dance to it. That's the only thing. Yeah. And I could say, like, Madonna meets Kurt Cobain.
Well,
as a songwriter.
It's a huge compliment. You know, it's funny. When I think about Kurt Cobain, I think about some of these places that, you know, they really look at lyrics and stuff like that. When Kurt Cobain came out with his song, nobody understood what he was saying. But the thing was
a spirit? Yeah.
Yeah. The song was a massive, massive, massive hit.
Yeah, yeah.
And so when people are such sticklers for certain things, I always think about that, teen spirit, and I'm like, well, that was a success. And sometimes people just love that. They just love not knowing what he's saying or the artist is saying, and that makes them go and check the lyrics. And so that gives the person more popularity. People don't understand. That's actually a great marketing tool. Great.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, one, I've learned a lot from analyzing Kurt's writing style. And I'll never forget an interview he did, and even a producer talking, saying, like, if you can't find a word, put in hey. And it's funny, if you listen to some of my music, you'll hear a lot of hey, hey's and yes, and they're catchy and they're fun, and it doesn't always have to be a, you know, word, or you have to mix it in. And again, like you said, sometimes like I'll sing stuff and be like, what is that about? But it's so catchy that it's like, oh, that's kind of cool. Well, yeah, it means something to me, but you come up with what it means for you. You know, I'm not dictating your path in life. You dictate what you like and get what you want from my words. So definitely.
How important is it for you to be seen as an authentic artist?
That's like probably right up there, to be honest. You know, when we talked about when you said you were streaming and sometimes you had a lot of people watching and sometimes you had nobody or very little people, I feel like, you know, you can't get into this, and I never got into this to say, oh, I want to be famous or I just want to be really rich. I mean, yeah, fame comes with part of that, but that shouldn't be the goal, and that has never been my goal, because believe me, if I wanted to be like make right off the bat so much money, I would have went to medical school and became a doctor because it's a lot easier.
Yeah, amen, sister. Amen.
Yeah, so, and especially being a woman trying to come up in the music business, that I could give you stories of when I was first coming out and how hard it was, you know, speaking to like a major label and them telling me, well, we already have a woman artist that does kind of what you do. We can only have one. What does that mean? Well, they had like 10 rock artist guys that sounded exactly the same. I'm like, and you can only, so, you know, it's not easy, but you do it.
Right.
Because you have a voice. And for me, being authentic has always been, that's why, and everyone's like, why don't you just be, you know, join a cover band and you can make all this money. You know, I'm on Long Island and that's like a big circuit here. And I don't put anyone down for doing that. I said, but that's not me.
Right.
You know? So yes, being authentic is pretty important to me. To answer your question.
I love that. Because I think, in no poo-poo on the artists that are out there doing their thing. And it's okay. If you want to be an artist that wants to chart, and obviously charting is great, and you want to make money out of this, that's wonderful. But I find that the most authentic artists, right from their soul, they really take time with their lyrics, their melodies. They really want to change. Or they want their listener or the audience to feel what they're trying to say. They want to connect. They want a meaningful connection.
Absolutely. And listen, the end game with anything, a career in music, is a job. So the end game is to be successful at it. You know, we all have to eat and feed our families. Like,
right. Exactly. And yes, we all want to make money. And and I've told a lot of independent artists, there's so many different ways. I think what's been interesting, what I've learned, a lot of independent artists think, oh, the touring and, you know, charting is the only way to make money. But there's so many different avenues, and you still can be an artist by getting your, like you, like getting your music in film, television, documentaries.
I thank God that, because when I started getting into licensing, the music business hadn't imploded yet. Like CD, it was still the old school way.
Right.
And I was like, this was a new thing. And I remember a good friend of mine, Lou Playa, he created Reverb Nation. And he was like, Gina, I want to introduce you to some people. And I've always had very great people around me to help introduce me to people. And it was the head guy at APM licensing. And I'm like, he's like, yeah, you got to. And I was like, what is this licensing? You give your music to people, you get paid, and they put it – like, it was so bizarre. But thank God I did it, because within 5 years, it was like the music business, just all the labels just imploded because of streaming.
Yeah,
so I wound up making my money that way. I wasn't doing a lot of touring anymore. I was playing out, but not like when I was doing Warped Tour. That was like that was like the height of, you know, you're doing it the old school way. I thank God that I got into the licensing piece, because, you know, that it did help make money and keep my career, which is, you know, the music career, you know, you make money and it goes right back into it.
Exactly. So, you know what, it's not like you're not even breaking even, because what people don't understand, you know, creating a single, it can cost from $500 to $5,000 or even more, depending on
I was
going to
say, let's go up into the thousands.
Yeah, and we don't break even. I mean, you know what? I talked to somebody about Spotify the other day, and I told people the pros and cons of online streaming. The con is obviously we don't make that money, half a cent for every stream, but the pros
it's a joke.
Is that people are going to get to know you as an artist. You may gain new fans because of the fact that you're on these streaming platforms. Now, the money part is poo-poo. And we still need to work on it. It's just poop.
That's the thing. I mean, at this point, really, it's only streaming. Like, no, it's never going back to someone's buying an album in a record store. It's never happening. So what needs to happen is legislation needs to be put in where we get paid more for that streaming. It shouldn't be a half a cent. When, you know what I'm saying, I got a million streams this month and I made 35 cents.
Yeah, that's the thing. Can you imagine this, though? So I've gotten checks from Music Reports or somewhere, and the check literally has been 16 cents. And are you kidding me? The stamp costs more, and the envelope to send me the check. And do they really think I'm going to deposit that check?
Yeah, I know. Well, I have it all. I don't even get it mailed, but it's all through like the computer, and I'll look and I get a breakdown of that. So I'm just like, okay, that's great. And I joke with other musician friends of mine. I was like, what'd you make from the streaming this month? I'm like, 32 cents.
Like, yeah, I'm going to Olive Garden. It's just ridiculous. It's sad, but I agree with you 100% that we need to get to a place where we're paid more. Now, you know, I was talking to somebody, a friend of mine was asking me if he should create some CDs. And I'm like, I still have boxes of CDs.
Nope. I would tell him no.
Yeah, well, that's what I said. I said, but here's the thing. Now, if he's a lyricist, but he's creating an album. And I said, look, if your purpose, because there's still some people, and I don't understand this, reviewers that won't accept anything but a CD. I said, if you do it for that purpose, now, if you're a touring artist and you sell merch, fine. You can
do that. Well,
But here's the thing. People can go to your concert or your gig and have their cell phone and automatically purchase your album or stream it or get your name and boom, bam.
And that's what happens. I mean, they don't even make CD players in cars,
know.
You know, are you going to have some of these old school people that want to do it that way, or they want a CD, but very far and few between. I mean, at this point as an artist, it's about branding, merchandising, and sadly, you know, you have to find another way to engage the audience and make financial repercussions, make financial backings on it.
Right.
You know,
TikTok.
Look at TikTok. People make tons of money there, and they're not even like artists. They're just
They're doing something. They're doing.
Hold on. I am sorry. My dog. Rocco, we're on an interview right now. Be quiet.
Stop, Rocco. I said hi. You know what I love about doing live shows? It's real life. The dog can bark at you.
I shut all my shades. I'm like, don't look at, because they have someone, they're getting stuff done across the street with the house. So he's like barking at people. I'm like, are you going to stop barking now? Are you kidding me?
It's okay. He basically has something to say. So we're glad that he has something to say. So where do you get your inspiration from when you're writing a song?
Well, I would say my life and life around me. So like a good friend of mine was going through something a while back, and you know, she was going through a divorce, and she was just every day talking to me about stuff, and I was like, you know, really like stuck with me hard in my heart, and I could relate within me. So usually if I write a song that's about something else I've seen or witnessed, I usually can relate myself within it somehow, whether it was from a past love or something. So I wound up writing Fly, Feel Love Tonight from this experience that this my good friend was going through. And it was funny because I played for her. I said, I want to thank you. Like, I feel like I've written one of my best songs by just, you know, of course I relate myself to it. So pretty much it's life. Like the things I write about, it's real. I'm not saying it's always about me, but it's real. It's either something I've experienced or been a part of or a close friend. I always tell my close friends, I said, listen, when you're my friend, just know you may show up. I'll never use your name, but you may see, I may release a song and be like, wait a minute, that sounds very familiar.
No, I love that. I mean, that's cool, and I'm glad your friends are cool with it. You're like, I'm not using your name, but I love this, depending on what the situation was, you felt like it was just, you had to write a song about it.
Exactly. I mean, believe me, I wouldn't be writing any, you know, I know where the limits are, but it is. For me, it's always been about real life experiences. You know, I'm like my song Brand New Start, I wrote that about, you know, back, you know, a few years back when everything was just so, everyone, and I don't want to get into a political rant at all, but when people were so against each other and back and forth, so I was like, you know what, I have something to say about this. And I'm a humanitarian, so for me, I know where I lie politically, but I'm, unless you're like some super extreme crazy person, like I feel like respecting other people's views are important.
Yeah.
And the song was more about, well, we all need like a reset here, you know?
Right.
So it's usually, like I said, it's always about life and usually my life.
I love that. So it's interesting. I was talking to a friend yesterday and we were talking because we're very good friends and we can agree to disagree. And the thing is, what we decided is that people need to just, you know, be open to listen. You don't have to agree with somebody else. Everybody has the right to their own opinions on anything. Now, facts are facts, but people have the right to their own opinion. And that's what we saw was just horrible in the past 6 years, is that people were getting bashed for their own opinion. And it's just like, is this America or is this America? It just didn't make sense anymore. I totally agree with you.
And you're never going to change. It's almost impossible to change. But like you said, if you listen, I'm always willing to listen and then think about it.
Me too.
And think about it. But that's it.
Right.
You know.
I'm with you 100%. So I'm going to play your song, Runaway. Tell me what that's about.
Ah, Runaway. Well, see, this is where I always go, I was just about to like spill it all out. I'm like, should I? So I like that obviously Runaway is something very meaningful to me, but I also like for people to listen to it and actually relate their situation. So Runaway could mean something for you totally different than what it meant for me, but I will give you a little, like, without divulging. Someone very, very close to me was pretty much leaving, like going to be away for quite some time.
Okay.
Not jail or anything. They just there was an opportunity they had to. Oh God, this is starting to sound bad. And it was hard. It was my, you know, a musical soulmate of mine, and it was very hard to have that person say, "Listen, I'm going here for like some time, for like a year, because I want to, you know, want to experience something different," and yada yada yada. So that I kind of just something like that. It's so hard without me fully telling you the story, but essentially loving somebody and them having to leave, and you wanting them to, but also being super upset about it.
Got it. All right. So we're going to have a word from our sponsor and we're going to play it. Hold on 1 second.
Hi, it's Jordan.
And Madison.
And we're Jay Madison out of Nashville, Tennessee. We'd love to tell you about B-Squared Management, artist services by artists for artists. Get your press, branding, single release, and sync success plan now at bsquaredmgmt.com.
And listen up to our latest single, Down, now on Spotify.
Dance eye to eye in a room, you and I. Oh.
I love the groove in that song.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm sure it's a very reminiscent sound of Billie Jean's.
Yes.
So I told you I have all these influences, and I'm sure you heard the whole Celebrate holiday in the middle with Madonna. And I always like to, like, nod my hat a little here and there to the artists that have influenced the sound and stuff like that. But again, I love that audience. I need to get one of these and just have it around my house. So, like, just like when I'm walking through, I just get cheered on. Like, I make, you know, once I make dinner, I get some cheers. This would be lovely.
Never thought about using it for that purpose, but I'm with you. I think I'm going to start doing that myself. I love that idea. I think it's fantastic. We deserve applause. What's one thing you wish you had known when you began your career?
Oh, geez. One thing I wish I... That is a good one. That's a good one. Huh. I guess, you know, when you first start, and I try to tell any new artist, because I do like to work with artists that are trying to make it or coming out, or I'll record some artists. I try to tell them, listen, don't be naive. Like, just because you write a song or you're recording and you're playing in a band, it doesn't mean you're going to make it right away. It's not, you know, I thought, I guess, in the beginning, you know, you go out there, you know, I was in a band first, not under my name, Super Genius, and we were doing the whole CBGB circuit and this and that, and I was like, for sure, we're getting signed, we're going to be rock stars, you know, so I guess I maybe would have liked to know how hard it actually is, unless you're fully connected in the business, you know.
Right.
If I was Madonna's kid, listen, I'm sure I'd have it a lot easier. So maybe that, outside of that, I never have regrets. I'm so happy that I followed what I wanted to do, because if I didn't, I think I would have always thought, well, what would I have done? If, like, you would have never known. So I guess that would be the one thing I wish I would have known, that it really is hard. Not that I don't know it would change anything.
Right.
Either.
Right.
And especially, I think I was also naive thinking that a woman, being a woman, that it would be harder. I didn't realize that, but I guess that's anywhere in life. Obviously, things are starting to change, and things have changed for some time, but when I started, it wasn't this past, you know, year or two or 5 years. I would have liked to known too, because I looked up to a lot of women artists. So I'm like, oh, look, they're all out there, but it wasn't then I started learning the hard facts that to every 10 male artists on radio, they would only allow one female artist on radio. I don't know if you know those rules. I mean, now again, things are changing, and have changed, but that's not when, you know, back in the day.
I mean, why does anything have to be about gender? If you're good at good at something, it is just the most, especially in music. It's music, people. Why is it a male or female? It just doesn't make any sense.
No, but I mean, I think that's just what life was like from back in the day. You know, women didn't have to go to work, you know, they stayed home. Now it's like women are raised that they can't, you know. I was actually at my sister-in-law's mother's house the other day, and it was, you know, now that things are, like, again, opening up, we're all out a little more and this and that. So I went with – and it was really – and I always love speaking to older people. I really do, because there's that generational wisdom, and there's that gap of, like, you know, we were talking about girls today and how, you know, back in the day there was – no one had partners. Like, you met someone at 17, you usually married them, and, that, you know, you were a virgin. And now it's different. But I said to her, I said, well – I said, think about how much things have changed. Like, women now have to go to, and they should, but back in the day it was like, no, you meet a man, you don't have to work, you don't have to go to school, you don't have to go to college, whatever. Now, to live, both male and women, or men, whatever, if it's same women, you have to work. You have to work now, because things are expensive. And I said, so things are different. So women aren't settling down at the age of 18.
Exactly.
So, and we're going to have partners. And it was a very cute conversation. It was cute, and I don't want to, like, go into the whole thing, but that's the same thing. Like it started very differently back in the day. So that's why gender was so important. Now who cares? Like, I don't care. I mean, it shouldn't matter. You know, if you're talented, it should be equal. Like you're talented, you're a talent. Okay, we have half male, half women, or whatever you want to call it.
I mean, most recently, though, in the country music industry, you know, they were only allowed to play one female on the radio. And it's like you're saying, just recently. And now it's changed. Now it's 50-50 because, you know, there was an uproar and a lot of people didn't know that. So now, because somebody said something about it, they had to change because people are just like, are you kidding me right now?
It's sad. And, you know, and as people get smarter and the younger generations come up more, the playing field gets better. I mean, even my own mother, and my mother was an amazing woman. She was so supportive of everything. I have wonderful parents in the sense of the support I got with music.
Right.
I mean, it was my mother's dream. So I think her watching me, she told me, she goes, I am living out what I wanted to do through you. She would tell me that all the time. But I'll never forget when I was younger, I always wanted a guitar. I'm like, Mom, get me a guitar. She's like, no, girls don't play guitar, Gina. Just keep singing. And I know she didn't mean that meanfully, and she wasn't trying to hold me back, but that was her generational upbringing. Like, and women didn't play guitars. I'm sure there were some, but not like, you know, when she was doing the Battle of the Band. She's like, they're all men play guitars. And I'm like, and then I finally got myself one once I got older. But, you know, it's just interesting how things are different from back in the day. But, you know, you gotta.
Yeah, totally. It's just crazy to me. What advice would you give somebody trying to break into the music industry?
Oof. Oh boy. I would say, oh boy. I honestly would tell them to, you have to go with what's going on. Okay. You need to be authentic, like we've already talked about.
Yeah.
You need to keep writing. You know, it depends what you want to do. Obviously, if you want to just be a singer, then you have to keep singing and perfect that and keep writing and find somebody. Like, everyone always wants to be like somebody. So if your goal is to be like an Adele, she does write, but she's mostly a vocalist.
Mm-hmm.
Well, figure out how she did it and kind of mimic that path. Now, mind you, things are constantly changing and have changed. I would absolutely get on TikTok, like these kids on TikTok now, and sing your song constantly, because there are people that have gotten noticed that way. And that's this day and age. Get on your Instagram and just keep writing and singing and networking. Networking is key. I mean, and that's something that's never going to change. That's what's helped me become successful in what I've done. And that was mostly because I was out there talking and networking with people, meeting people, collaborating. Yeah. Collaboration is huge. So that would be my – and don't stop. Just keep going.
Keep on going. You have to
because it's part luck. It's part – it's a lot of – there are so many – because think about how many talented artists there are out there.
Yeah.
And sometimes you'll hear someone on the radio like, well, they're not that great of a singer. That's not that great. But they did – there was a little bit of luck, and there was probably a crap load of networking.
Right.
You know what I mean? So you have to do it. You have to do all those facets, and you have to keep going. It's not – don't think you – just because you've released a song, you're going to be number one, you know, you're going to be signed the next day, or you're going to be with some record label the next day. You're better off getting struck by lightning.
Exactly. And I would also –
you have a better chance.
You have to believe in yourself. If you don't, nobody's going to believe in you. You have to have that mindset.
Exactly. Yep. That's what I try to tell people, because people have asked me too, and I try to give them the advice. I don't want to crush anyone's dream, because I still am releasing songs. I'm still making, you know, I'm still making, again, these last year and a half with the pandemic, it's been very difficult. But I still have my songs being placed. I'm getting ready to release a new single again, you know, and you got to just keep, and I feel like I've done well, and I know I have, and I you know, you just got to keep doing, you just got to keep doing it.
Got to keep, see, that's a song. Got to keep doing it. So we're going to play your song, Keep On. I think that
I was
going
to say, well, you got to keep on.
You got to keep on. So tell us what that song's about.
Keep On. Oh, let me think back. When I wrote that song, Keep On Saying the World's on Fire, Keep On Singing to Me, Keep On. Okay, so this, I'm like thinking about the lyrics again. This was one of those songs, again, it was a very crazy time, and people, you know, because you have to think about between 4 or 5 years ago, and I'm not going against either or, there was a lot of turmoil before the election. And then we had a president that, whether you loved him or not, whatever, I'm not even going to discuss that, but there was more turmoil. Then we got thrown into some pandemic. So I think Keep On, literally, I wrote that right before, like during that election thing when everything was just like crazy. So I think that's where a lot of the the lyrically, verse-wise, I know that has a lot to do with that whole crazy time. And then Keep On, the whole message in the chorus is just, you got to just keep on going. Listen, we're going to all be all right, and we're just going to keep moving. This is just in the world right now, like, regardless. And I kind of think about that with life. Like, I try to tell my younger nieces, you know, that are in their 19, 20, 17, I try to tell them, I said, listen, life is like waves, and it's how you ride them. Don't let yourself get too high, and don't let yourself get too low. Something that you think is so important today, and you're allowing it to drain you, is going to mean nothing a year from now. So don't let it. Like, put your energy into it, because obviously it's part of the life, but don't go crazy. Like, and I used to say that to everybody. Like, I'm not going to sit here and not be friends with family members over somebody that has no bearing on our family, that in 2 years we're not even going to speak his name. You know, it's silly. And I think that's what in life, period, keep on. You got to just keep on moving, because it's all going to be all right. I usually have some sort of positive. I try to have some sort of positive out tone with my songs too, lyrically, when I'm writing.
All right, let's play it.
Far away, far away, I want you far away.
love the beat on that one. I was grooving. Loved it.
Yeah, yeah. That, listening back, I'm like, that's right. Far away. I want you far away. I just wanted to just get out of here. And, yep, now I remember. It's funny. I sing them all the time, but being asked about my songs, again, like I said, I usually don't divulge into what they mean to me. It's more about what you want to get out of it. But, yeah, Keep On was, you know, that was the Billboard hit. That was just amazing, you know, writing. It was funny because I was talking to a radio guy, and he's like, you know, you have hit songs. I'm like, thank you. And he's like, let's try to get it out there. Let's see if we can get it on the Billboard charts. And I had given him one of my songs. He's like, this is really good. What else are you working on? I said, oh, I can show you a quick demo. It's not fully mixed yet, whatever. I said, I'll send it to you. And it was Keep On. And he was like, oh, that is the one. And so it was pretty special, you know. I don't know. They were all my favorite. They all have some piece of my heart.
So
that's a fun song.
So there's one person listening, and I want to tell this person the streaming is going to cut off in 28 seconds. So you can listen to the rest once we're done, because we're actually... It's already been 45 minutes, and it's been awesome having Gina Cutillo on here. Please let everybody know where they can find you on the internet.
Oh, my God, everywhere. You can go to GinaCutillo.com, anything with Gina Cutillo, GinaCutillo. You can find me on YouTube, Spotify, everywhere. Any social media outlet, you just put my name in and you'll find me.
Just Google you.
Yeah, just Google me. Exactly. All you have to do is Google me. Yeah, I know a few people are listening. I don't know if they will. They'll be able to hear it after, too, if people couldn't hear it,
yeah,
like, live.
Yeah, no. They'll be able to hear everything. It's just the streaming portion that just ends after 45 minutes. But I do still see one phone number that's on here that's a person that's listening. But before we go, I usually ask this question. What is one quote that you live by?
Do not look back.
Amen.
Moving forward.
Amen. I like that one. That is very profound and so true. There's no reason to look back. There is.
Nope. It really. There. Yeah. We all love memories, but you know what I mean when I say don't look. Like, if there is something, just keep moving forward.
Amen. And thank you so much, Gina, for being on Chatting
thank
with Nat.
Thank you so much for having me, Natalie. I really appreciate it. You're awesome to talk to. I really had a great time.
I love to make people feel comfortable. And you're an awesome artist. You really think about the listeners, and you want them to get as much as they can from your music. You speak your truth. You're an empowered woman. This is what I love. I love to be able to sit freely and just shoot the shit, kind of, basically.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. And I could tell that I have to now look you up, Miss Artist. And I could tell that you're very good at this, because I did feel very comfortable. And, you know, and it's fun. And this is when you get the best kind of stuff happening, is when you could just sit and relax and talk.
And not worry about what people think. You're going to say whatever you want, because this world is not about other people. It's about you and what you want to bring out.
Absolutely. Next time we do it with a glass of wine. and then the shit gets real.
You should do that. Next time I need to get you on an Instagram live and we can have a glass of wine. We'll shoot the shit there.
Yeah, you'll be like, oh, now bitch has got her gloves off now.
Yeah, exactly. And then we can show people that it's okay to be you. It's okay to be authentic. It's okay. Don't worry.
Absolutely.
It's so.
I don't apologize. I have my shy moments, and I'm, you know, humbled, but I am loud, and I say what I want to say. I have no, there's no apologies. I'm not a mean person. I try very hard to be, like I said, a good person. You know, it takes a lot for me to dislike somebody. Like, they have to be doing really bad things.
I'm exactly the same way, you know. And it's so interesting. I've been doing all these, sharing all these inspirational quotes, and some people have contacted me and said, oh, my God, you don't know how much I needed this today. And it's amazing how many people don't know how to love themselves or are afraid to be because they're so worried about what other people will think. And I think I think that's really tragic. I really think it's a tragic thing.
It is. And it's sad. You know, I thank my mother for that. She was always this woman. She's half Puerto Rican and half Irish. And she raised, and my father was 100% Italian. And she raised us like, I think I get a lot of how I feel, my humanitarianism from her. Like, she was like, people are people, Gina, and people have to have their truth. And, you know, and as long as no one's hurting somebody, you know, it's okay. Like, being different is what makes the world. Like, and it's funny that I don't get how people want to be, you have to be like this, you have to be like that. Nobody is the same. Not one, two people are the same. So let's celebrate the differences instead of looking down at them. You know what I mean?
That's profound, and that is so true. You know what? We just have to keep doing it. We have to keep showing people they just need to be happy, happy.
That's exactly. And here's another thing. It's funny. I always try to, like, I'm like the cool aunt. So I'm always trying to give my nieces and stuff tidbits that I wish I got. And I tell them, I'm like, I just want you to know there's no such thing as being happy 100% all the time. You can just ride the wave. You don't have to be, like, to know what happiness is, you have to feel sad too or feel lonely. Like, and that's okay. Like, that's what I think when people start to get themselves really, like, in an uproar, like, well, I'm not happy today. All right, so you're having a day. Just keep walking. You know, do something, get outside, go get some fresh air. And believe me, and there are days I have to remind myself too, I'm like, especially during this whole lockdown stuff, I would be like, all right, stop, talk. You know, you need to start saying some good things to yourself. But it's okay. You know what we're having? This is not going to be forever. This too shall pass. That's another good saying I love. This too shall pass. And it always does.
Amen to that.
Listen up here.
Hey, man. Yeah, we're just chatting. We're like soul sisters. This is what it's about. Together, we are stronger.
Yes, absolutely. And I love everything you guys stand for. And that's why I was like, you know what? This is something I would love to be a part of.
Thank you
so
much. So
I thank you so much again for having me on.
Oh, no. It was truly an honor. I think people will learn a lot from this interview, our chat. And they can learn a lot from you. So I want everybody to check your website out, Google you all over the place, follow you.
Yeah, and message me. Like, listen, if people want to talk and they, you know, I'm there. You know, I may not get right back to you right away, but I will. I always respond. People, you know, I've had younger artists message me, and, you know, I'll always help out. You know, I don't need anything. I just, if it helps them get on the right path, that makes me feel good, because I had a lot of people helping me too. You know, yes, am I DIY? But DIY to a point. Like, I had, that guy I mentioned, Lou Plyer, I always called him my silent manager. He wasn't my manager, but he saw my authenticness and he loved my music, and he gave me a lot of opportunities. Like, just, hey, Gina, come here, you know, fly out to LA. We're going to each, you know, it was insane, the things. But that's how I became successful, by knowing who were good people and saying, okay, I'm going to do this and I'm going to go meet this person, you know. And again, I met some bad people too, but I got away from them. You know, I knew, like, this isn't, you know, I'm not selling my soul to the devil just to do music, because that was offered to me too, you know, being a woman. And I'm like, and I'll never forget what the guy said to me. He's like, have you ever had a one night stand in college or anything? I said, well, of course, yes. Well, think about what that got you, and think about what this could give you. Like, oh, yeah, no, thank you. I have something called integrity. Thank you very much. And no success or music is worth that.
I agree with you. No, So, people that want to offer that, they're just stupid. And they think
you're getting all my secrets now.
Yeah. Oh my God, that's just awful.
But
thank
you
so much, Gina.
You're welcome.
For being on Chatting with Nat. It's been awesome. Again, let's schedule an IG Live with a glass of wine, and let's just show them how it's done.
I would love that, Natalie. Would love it.
All right. Well, you have a wonderful day and a wonderful rest of the week.
Yes, you too, hon. You too. Thank you.
Thank you. Everyone, that was Gina Cutillo, and she's awesome. Thank you so much for being on Chatting with Nat. Until next time.
Bye.
Chatting with Nat is a podcast for independent women seeking to speak their truth and to break down barriers. We host honest conversations that help to guide and empower women. Speak your truth and set yourself free. Let your voice be heard.